there is a blind spot at the heart of modern computing. For the last 70 years, every computer chip on Earth has been built on the same foundation. Binary. Just zeros and ones. And no one ever questioned it. But what if that was just the historical accident? What if computers wouldn't stop at two states? What if they had a third? That's the idea behind ternary computing. And this simple idea could unlock levels of efficiency binary could never touch. And it's not just a theory. Decades ago, the Soviets actually built one. And today, this story taking a very unexpected turn. Subscribe if you're curious, and let's get into it. Imagine the Soviet Union in the 50s. They had a strong start. They built one of the Europe's very first digital computers. Soon after, they released the best one, a machine that outpaced America's best computer, UNIVAC 1. But this triumph didn't last. And here is the real reason. At the time, in the US, IBM was cranking out computers by the thousands. Meanwhile, in the USSR, every machine was almost handmade, built with scarce parts and no scale of production. At this time, at Moscow State University, engineer Nikolai Brusentsov and his small team were cornered. Binary mainframes were too costly, sealed inside government labs. Academia couldn't get near them. That's when Brusentsov chose to fight back, to build a new kind of computer, simple enough to build it with the scraps he had, cheap enough that students could finally put their hands on it. Brusentsov searched for answers, spending months on finding a new way forward. And that's when he met Sergei Sobolev, a brilliant mathematician who introduced him to ternary mathematics, a system built not on two states, but three. This moment was like discovering a color TV in a black and white world. Suddenly, there was a whole new dimension. And together, they began exploring how this elegant idea could be turned into a working computer. What's interesting, Brusentsov argued that binary was just a historical accident. Relays and vacuum tubes had only two states. That's how zero and one logic became the default. And since then, nobody questioned it. But Brusentsov and his team did. They started to work on Siatun, the world's first computer to run on three logic states. Minus one for no, one for yes, and zero, sort of, for both. We will dive into the details of how exactly it works later in the video, but for now imagine that each bit, so-called treat, can represent now three states instead of two. That means more data can be processed in each computing step, and math can be done with fewer moves. Even negative numbers in this case don't need an additional sign bit, so subtraction and addition became naturally easier. And soon Brusentsov realized that this elegant math could turn into circuits that were simpler, more efficient, and far cheaper to build. After 2 years of non-stop work, in 1958, they finally unveiled Siatun, the world's first ternary computer. Production began the following year at the Kazan Mathematical Machines factory and lasted for several years. The hardware was primitive by today's standards, just 2,000 magnetic elements and 100 germanium transistors. But here is the thing, Siatun came live on a very few components, and it was at least 10 times cheaper than the binary machines of the day. Based on this paper, The Situn used about 30% fewer parts than a binary machine. It was radical, but it worked. In 1959, the Soviets had something the West didn't. A working ternary computer. About 50 units were built and sent to research institutions. But then reality hit. The fab had no interest in scaling up the production, and the Situn was just discontinued. And that's really sad. It didn't fail because it didn't work, but because the Soviet Union lacked both the ecosystem and the political will to push it forward. And it also failed because the world had already chosen binary. Memory, transistors, software, the entire stack was locked into two states. So Situn never really stood a chance, and it just faded into history. Fast forward to today, and now AI is burning through energy like there is no tomorrow. Data centers are pushing power grids to its limits. And once again, computing is hitting a wall. The same wall Brosensov saw in the 1950s. Binary might not be enough. And this time, with advanced chip manufacturing and new semiconductor materials, three-state logic might finally have its moment. And Huawei just proven that this might be possible. Let me show you. Every computer chip today is built of tiny devices called transistors. And these devices switch between two states. A classical transistor does it by switching at a certain threshold level. You can think of threshold level as of person's patience level. Imagine you annoy someone just a little bit, so nothing happens. But if you cross this level, boom, and you get a reaction. That's exactly how a transistor works. That's the foundation of binary logic behind all modern chips. Now imagine, a regular transistor has just one threshold level, just like a regular person. But if we want to build a ternary computer, we need to add something extra. We need a device that can clearly tell apart three different states. How do you do that? By giving a transistor two threshold levels instead of one. And that's the magic to unlock three states. And from there, you can start building the entire computer in ternary logic. And this means you have to rebuild all logic circuits, including memory, so it can switch between three states instead of two. And wow, that's quite some work. And here it's getting exciting. Huawei just released their new ternary chip at 7 nanometers. And we will have a look into how it works exactly in details in a moment. But before that, have you ever wondered how much of your personal information is out there online? Your name, home address, phone number, even information about your family members could be floating around online. This happens because data brokers collect and sell your personal information without you even realizing it. And this exposes you to risks of data breaches and personal security. That's where Incogni, the sponsor of today's episode, comes in. Incogni helps you to regain control by removing your personal information from the databases that brokers rely on. I use it myself, and you will be surprised how simple it is. You sign up, authorize Incogni to act on your behalf, and they send data protection law compliant requests to these companies, forcing them to remove your information from their databases. And just now, Incogni introduced a new custom removals feature. It allows you to submit links to websites that expose your data, and Incogni's experts will remove it beyond their automatic system. And then you can track every step of the progress right from your dashboard. I highly recommend you to try out Incogni. It's a simple way to reduce unwanted spam and keep your data off the grid. Use my code INTECH at the link below to get 60% off their annual plan. For decades, ternary logic was trapped in the lab. Clever, but impossible to scale. Over years, old patents from Soviet pioneers and even IBM have long expired. And just recently, Huawei released a new patent. Brand new patent for a ternary chip. The trick here is special devices, special transistors that have not one, but two threshold levels. And this allows chip to distinguish clearly between three different states. And from there, they rebuilt all the building blocks, including logic gates and memory. A ternary memory cell can now hold three values instead of two, packing more data into fewer space. Let's make it real with one simple example. AND gate. And this actually takes us back to the Seton computer, which also featured these kind of gates. Here we picked this particular AND gate because it's very simple, basic, but at the same time essential part of every computer chip. Without AND gates, computer can't make decisions. Its job is simple. Only if all inputs are true, then it gives me true. So you can trust it. In binary logic, with zeros and ones, it's very simple. And it's basically just four possible combinations. In ternary chip, things get spicy. Each input can be minus one, zero, or plus one. This gives us 27 possible combinations. In this new setup, AND gate returns you the lowest value. If at the input you have plus one and plus one, you get plus one. If you have plus one and zero, you get zero. Anything with minus one, you get minus one. As you can see with this simple example, now each bit carries more information compared to binary, meaning high information density. This means you can do more with the same amount of input wires, and this results in more compact chip circuits and more efficient designs. Huawei's new patent showed that their new chip used 40% fewer devices, 60% less power, and ran 20% faster. But here is the thing about patents. Patents are tricky. Now, for example, in my startup, we are deciding what to patent and what not to patent, because whatever you patent is publicly available. That's why the biggest breakthroughs often never get patented. And this means there can be a lot more going behind the scenes, which we haven't seen yet. And that's exciting. Subscribe to the channel right now to stay up to date with the most exciting updates in technology. In fact, the biggest promise of three-state logic is efficiency at scale. And right now, training massive neural networks is a multi-million dollar power bill. Ternary chips could slash the energy bill and speed things up. In a data center, that could mean cutting power use by a third, while boosting throughput. That sounds almost too good to be true. And that's where the story takes a turn. Ternary chips are still digital, but because they use three states, they sit halfway to analog. So we have digital chips which are binary, just two states, we have analog chips which have infinite states, and in between sit ternary chips. This could be a perfect trade-off, but there is a catch. Noise. A ternary device has to distinguish between three different states, not just two. And even the tiniest noise or manufacturing flaw can blur them, causing errors. Building reliable three-state logic at scale is brutally hard. And don't forget, today's entire semiconductor ecosystem is built for binary. Software, memory, compilers, everything. That was a challenge in the 1950s, and it hasn't gone away. The solution here could be graphene. And carbon nanotube transistors, one of the most powerful tricks nature gives us for electronics. These are tiny, rolled-up sheets of graphene, just a few nanometers wide. And these are a perfect match for ternary logic, because their size naturally decides how they switch. And by changing the diameter of a nanotube, you can clearly set three logic levels. That makes them perfect for ternary logic. In fact, advantages of graphene go way beyond that. Graphene itself can move electricity incredibly fast, even at very low power. And for any kind of chip, that means cooler processors, longer battery life, and big energy savings in data centers. That's why TSMC and iMac are betting on it as one of the strongest paths for the post-silicon era. And it's not just talk. One of the recent IEEE papers showed a ternary chip built with carbon nanotubes transistors at 32 nanometers. The result? 45% less area, 30% less energy for the same AI operations binary chips do today. And that's not an incremental step. That's a big leap. So, will ternary replace binary? Let me know your thoughts in the comments. Probably, it will find a way alongside binary for the applications where we need it the most. Because history shows us that the biggest revolution in computing and beyond coming not from having more of the same, but from daring to try something entirely different. And the same goes to you. The next big leap in your life or your career may come from one thing everyone else is too afraid to try. Connect with me on LinkedIn and check out my newsletter. We send it out weekly. All the links you will find in the description box below. A lot of good stuff. Now, check out this deep dive in the future of US chip manufacturing, or this one, deep dive into the robotics, the insane technology behind the first human clone. And I will see you there. Ciao.